gives new life. And this offspring is your life. So you take care of this offspring. It's your life. It's coming from you. For I hate divorce, says the Lord, the God of Israel. The one who covers his garment with violence, says the Lord of hosts. You should be on guard then for your wife, and you must not break. So what the prophet Malachi has said, Jesus made firm. And this is stated in all the three synoptic gospels, that he has done away with divorce. It was not so in the beginning. So although it's very clear in Deuteronomy that a person can divorce the wife, but Jesus went back to Genesis. Moses allowed you to have this because of your hard-heartedness. It was just a concession. But let's go back to the original plan. So that's very clear here. Okay? Another example is about the priesthood. The priesthood for the Israelites is the priesthood of Aaron. Only a particular group coming from the tribe of Levi, coming from the family of Aaron, now can be priests. But in the New Testament, in Isaiah 61, we are told, strangers shall stand ready to pasture your flock. Foreigners shall be your farmers and vine dressers. You yourselves shall be called priests of the Lord, ministers of our God. You shall be called. You shall eat the wealth of the nations, and in the riches you will boast. So who is this you? Strangers, foreigners, not even Jews can be priests. And somehow we also find that what Moses has said in Mount Sinai, that you shall be a holy people, a nation of priests. Saint Peter applied that to all the Christians. Some of them are even non-Jews, that you shall be a holy people, a nation of priests. So the priesthood now is open to all. And for us Christians, this is something that also you should stress. We don't teach this very much. The common priesthood of all the baptized. That all of them are priests. All of them can offer sacrifice. All of them can sanctify. Because all are priests. So not only a particular group of people. So this opening of the priesthood to all. In fact, in the history of the church, the only way of climbing up in the social status in the feudal society was to become a religious and to become a priest. That was the only way of climbing up in the social status. Now, because they had the nobility, which is of blood. If you're a son of a duke, then you can live in the palace and so on. So there's no way for an ordinary man to go up the ladder of society except if you become a monk or you become a nun or you become a priest. So that means this is kind of opening to all because it's not just related to a particular blood or to particular status. Another example of the discontinuity is uncircumcision. So in Jeremiah 4, we have only one particular verse, but you find this also in so many other prophets. We are told, be circumcised for the Lord. Remove the foreskins of your hearts, people of Judah and inhabitants of Jerusalem, or else my anger will break out like fire and burn so that no one can quench it because of your evil deeds. So it's not removing the foreskins of your flesh. That's circumcision. No, it's not written in the flesh, but the foreskins of your hearts. No? So you will be known as my people not because you are physically circumcised, but because you are spiritually circumcised. No? So it is written in your hearts, in your commitment. It's not in your flesh only. No? The third relationship is progression. Progression, which is also related, progression related also to continuity and related to discontinuity. No, it is continuous because it came from the Old Testament, discontinued because there's a progress, there's a betterment of what was in the Old Testament. Jesus, far from being in opposition to the Israelite scripture, revoked them as provisional, bringing them to fulfillment in his person, in his mission, and in his paschal mystery. That's why for us Christians, we are Christians not because we follow the Bible. I repeat, we are Christians not because we follow the Bible. We are Christians because we follow Jesus Christ. And Jesus is the ultimate revelation of God. Is the definitive and the ultimate revelation of God. Definitive, ibig sabihin, wala na may dadagdag pa. No, ultimate, that is no other revelation coming after Him. And that's precisely a consequence because we believe that Jesus is the Son of God. If God sent His Son, could He have other message that He had given through His Son? Could be an insult to the Son. Pinadala ko niyo yung anak ko, may iba pa kong sasabihin na pinadala galing sa iba? Yung anak ko na mismo pinadala ko? So it is a consequence of our belief that Jesus is the Son of God, the beloved Son of God, the only begotten Son. So when God sent His Son, He gave us everything. Everything that He wanted to say, Jesus has said. And not only Jesus has said, Jesus has performed. Because the revelation of Jesus is not only by His words, but also by His works. So we know who Jesus is and the message of the Father through Him, not only by what He said, but by what He did also. Okay? So He has come to fulfill, but the fulfillment is not just to do, but to put the deeper meaning of the law, the deeper understanding of the law. And that is the fulfillment that Jesus has said. Okay? So, about God. The New Testament holds on to the monotheistic faith of Israel, but makes clear that the triune God already foreshadowed in the Old Testament. So, in the Old Testament, we have the revelation of the one God. In the New Testament, with the revelation of the triune God. Triune, triune, tri, three, one. The three in one God. The three and one God. No. And this three and one God is already foreshadowed. Again, it's not bigla na dumating. It was already there in the New Old Testament, but it was somehow just shadow. No. It has adumbrated. Like, God creates by His Word. But His Word re-exists with God and is God and was made flesh in Jesus. So the Old Testament, God created by His Word. And Jesus has said, John has said very clearly in John 1, that everything was created by the Word, by the Logos. That this Word is with God. That this Word is God. It's already there. Since Genesis, only it was not identified, no, as a person. It was just an activity. God creates by the breath of His mouth. That is in Psalm 31:36. This breath is the Holy Spirit sent by the Father by the risen Christ. So in creation, there is the work of the Father, it, by the Son, it is His Word, and with the Holy Spirit by the breath of His mouth. Okay? Human beings, there are just samples to show you about the progression to make it clear, no, how it is done. The human being is created noble in the image of God. But the most perfect image of the invisible God is Christ, is Jesus. That's why Jesus is the perfect man. And Pope John Paul II has been telling us that Jesus is the revelation of God and the revelation of man. If you want to know who God is, go to Jesus. If you want to know who man is, go to Jesus. He's the perfect man. So the more we follow Jesus, the more we become perfect as human beings. As human beings. That's why there is no dichotomy between being godly and being human. The more godly you are, the more human you are. And that is found in Jesus. He is the perfect man because He is the man that is created in the image of God in a perfect way. Get it? So our model of being man is not Adam. Our model of being man is Jesus. It's Jesus. We are invited to become images of Christ. Jesus becomes our example. We should have the thoughts of Christ. We should be like Christ. And Jesus invites us to follow Him, to be like Him. That's a constant invitation. That following of Jesus is not just physical, but becomes the model. And in this way, we become truly human beings. That's why the more we become like Christ, we are not disoriented from our own identity, but become more rooted from our, to our human identity. And here we have to fight against some modern psychologists who say, be yourself, be yourself. So, oh, ano ka ba? Ganto ako eh. No, sometimes in the seminary, they don't want to be formed. Ganto ako eh. No, ganto ako eh. But that's not a Christian model. The Christian model is to deny yourself. And become Jesus. And here you see the invitation, deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow Me. And by following Him, it is when you die to yourself that you find yourself. That you become truly who you are. If you die to yourself, to what you think you are. If you die to your own self-image, you become truly what you are, what God wants you to be. And Jesus is that way. Hindi ba maganda? No, everything comes in place. No, sa kanyang relationship, no. We are called to be the new creation. No, so especially Easter, we are called to be that, the new creation, the new man. Take out the old man. Be the new man, the new creation. But you may say, can we do that? Can we become like Christ? Yes! Why? Because He has given us His Spirit. That means He has given us His power. The power that it is the work of the Spirit to conform us to Jesus. That's the work of the Spirit. So it's not our own capability, but it is God who enables us to do that by giving us the Spirit. That's why Jesus says, I will leave you, but I will not leave you orphaned. I give you another advocate, a paraclete, another help. So what it tells us we can do, the people, another example of the progression, the New Testament takes for granted the election of Israel as irrevocable. You find that in Romans. Now, God does not regret what He has chosen. Israel preserves intact its prerogatives as the chosen people. They belong to the natural, they are the natural branch of the vine. And its priority status in history, in the offer of salvation, and in the Word of God. That's why the Word of God was first preached to Israel. That's why Jesus said in Matthew, I have come for the lost sheep of Israel. Later on, as He says, go out into the whole world. But first, He concentrated Himself among the Israelites. That was His mission. It was the mission He gave to the 12. And later on, it was what was extended. Okay? That's why we are recovering this when John Paul II says that the Jews are our elder brothers. Our elder brothers. We're not different from them. So there's a special connection between us Christians and the Jews because of that relationship, you know, as the people of God. God has offered to Israel a new covenant. A new covenant. This is established in the blood of Christ. As offered to Israel, a new covenant. And this new covenant is established now in the blood of Christ, not in the blood of the Lamb. And this is what we are reminded every time at the consecration in the Mass. Offering His blood for the salvation of many. The church is conscious of existing only in the virtue of belonging to Jesus Christ, the Messiah of Israel, and because of its link to the apostles who were all Israelites. Far from being a substitution for Israel, the church is in solidarity with that people. So, remember, that's why what Jesus said is true. Salvation comes from the Jews. When Jesus told the Samaritan woman in John chapter 4, salvation comes from the Jews. Really, why? Salvation comes from the Jews. Jesus was a Jew. No, and salvation came from Him. And He was a product of the Jewish people. That's why Matthew started his gospel with a genealogy. That's why we have the genealogy also in Luke. No, it started from Him. And also, the apostles were all Jews. The first Christians were Jews. That's why the first crisis of the church was its identity. Who can belong to the church? Only the Jews. Because it was natural for them to think that only the Jews can become Christians. Because the Christ was promised to the Jews. Jesus was a Jew. The apostles were Jews. The first Christians were Jews. So when other people came to believe in Christ, they were thinking they should first become Jews. They should first be circumcised. They should first follow the law. Then they can become Christians. So that was the crisis in Antioch, which was brought to Jerusalem and decided by the first council of the church in Luke chapter 15, the council in Jerusalem. And that council has repercussions, no, even to us, or else we would not have been Christians. If then the decision of the council was only for the Jews. No, but it's for all. We now are Christians because we believe in Jesus. So our connection to Jesus is our faith. No longer our blood, no longer by race. So it opens up the universality of the Christian faith. Okay, so we are aware of that. However, we are aware where we began. Gentile Christians are grafted to the olive tree, which is Israel. Yes, Romans. That's why Paul was telling the Christians, he was writing to mostly Gentile church of Rome. So be careful. If the natural branch was cut off because they were not faithful, how much more we who are not the natural branch? We are just grafted to that original tree. So if we are not faithful, we also be cut off. So do not take your Christianity for granted. No. The reign of God is no longer confined to Israel alone, but open to all, including the pagans, the Gentiles, with a place of honor for the poor and the oppressed. So that's the kingdom of God now. The Jews, the original purpose of the Jews, as found in Isaiah, was that they should be the light to the nations. However, the Jews were not true to it. They were just contented that they are the chosen people. So that's why the Jewish religion is not a missionary religion. You don't have missionary Jews. Because for them, it's only for them. But then, do you think that they're selfish? Hindi naman. Ang kanilang pananaw is this, that if they become true to the covenant, they will save the whole world through their fidelity. But the whole world need not become Jews. Need not become Jews. But they will save the whole world by their fidelity. Now, that's why the faithful Jews are doing that, as faithful as possible. And the way that they know their fidelity is by faithfulness to the law. That's why they are meticulous in following the law. It's not just for them, but because this is their mission, as they think, to make also the rest of the world saved through them. Iba yung pananaw natin. Yung pananaw natin, we can save others by making them accept Jesus. That's why we are a missionary religion. Kaya tanggapin si Jesus. Okay? But in this kingdom, there's a special place for the poor and the oppressed. 1 Corinthians. Consider your own calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. Rather, God chose the foolish of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly and despised of the world, those who count for nothing, to reduce to nothing those who are something, so that no human being might boast before God. So this is how the kingdom of God is open up to all, but especially to the lowly. That's why your being lowly is not something to be ashamed of, but it is precisely your prerogative to belong to the kingdom. Okay? Thank you.